Hello everyone, welcome to Insecta channel. So today we'll discuss about the sericulture. As we all know, silk is a natural fiber and it is prepared by the silkworms. So these are the silkworm. They will prepare the silk, and rearing of the silkworm to produce the silk is known as sericulture. So this is the definition. Then the major activity of sericulture, it comprise of food plant cultivation to feed the silkworm. See, suppose this is the worm. So this worm needs food. So to provide the food to this worm, you have to cultivate the plant also. So the point is given, the major activity in sericulture is food plant cultivation. That means we have to cultivate this plant to provide food for the silkworm, then we have to rear the silkworms. So these silkworm, they will produce the cocoon, and after reeling that cocoon, you can find the silk filament. This is the silkworm. These are the egg of silkworm. This is the mulberry plant, because this one is mulberry silkworm. Okay, so they are monophagous pest of mulberry plant, so only you have to provide the mulberry plant to this silkworms, not this moth, to the silkworm. Then these are the cocoon. Inside the cocoon you will find the pupa. So the cocoon without pupa, suppose you are removing the pupa, then only this cocoon is there. So the cocoon without pupa is known as shell. Next we'll see the types of silkworm. So there are four different types of silkworm, each of which is produced by a distinct variety of silkworm feeding on different host plant. So what are those four variety? First one is mulberry, then tusser silk, then eri silk, then muga silk. So this mulberry, the variety name is, the scientific name of the mulberry silkworm is Bombyxis mori, belongs to the family Bombycidae, and all are Lepidoptera. The moth is there, means they belongs to the order Lepidoptera. Then tusser silkworm, the scientific name is Anthria mylita or Anthria perni or royally or proeli. So these are the scientific name of tusser silkworm. So the family of this tusser silkworm is Saturninidae. Okay, Saturninidae is the family of tusser silkworm, and eri silkworm and muga silkworm. These three, 1, 2, 3, they belongs to the family Saturninidae. Whereas mulberry silkworm only, they belongs to the family Bombycidae. Then we'll see the scientific name of eri silkworm, that is Phyllosoma ricini. Then muga silk, Anthria asama. So we'll see now the host. For the mulberry silkworm, the host is mulberry plant, that is Morus alba or Morus indica. Then this mulberry silkworm cocoon are reelable. That means you can reel it in reeling machine. You can put the cocoon and you can get the silk thread. So it is reelable. And the cocoon color is white and creamy. Then they are domesticated, and producing state are West Bengal, Karnataka, UP. Next, tusser silkworm. So tusser are also reelable, but their cocoon color is brown and coppery, and they are wild type, and you will find this tusser silkworm in Bihar, Odisha, MP. Next, the eri silkworm, that is unreelable, and they are white in color, and they are also domesticated, and you will find this eri in northeastern state and Assam. And this eri silkworm host is castor. Then the primary host is castor, whereas the secondary host are cassiru, tapioca. Then for the tusser silkworm, the host are asan and arjun. Whereas for the muga silkworm, the primary host are som and swalu. Then it is also reelable, but the cocoon color is golden yellow, and they are semi-domesticated. And Assam is the monopoly of muga silk. So you will find this silk in Assam only. This is mulberry, eri, muga, tusser. So these are the moth, these are the larva, these are the moth for the mulberry, tusser, eri, muga. Then what is silk? So silk is a protein fiber produced by the silkworm for spinning the cocoon. So you remember, silk is a protein fiber which is produced by the silkworm. So the purpose of cocoon is to provide, what is the purpose of cocoon? As we know, here you have seen, this is the cocoon. So what is the purpose of this cocoon? See, inside the cocoon, pupa will be there. So the cocoon is very hard. The shell, I have told, shell. So shell is very hard. So it will give a protective covering for the silkworm during the most critical period of its life stage, that is the pupal stage. So pupal stage means they cannot move, they will undergo in an inactive stage, but they will be live, right? So at that time, if something will happen, they cannot protect themselves. So the main function of this cocoon, they are providing protective casing to the silkworm. Next, basically there are two proteins which form the silk fiber. So this is the silk fiber. So in this silk fiber you will find two protein. One is fibroin, another one is sericin. So fibroin, which constitute the core of the fiber, whereas sericin is the waxy substance. Suppose this is the fiber, so core of the fiber is made with fibroin only the waxy substance is sericin. So these protein are synthesized by the silkworm from the leaf it feeds during its larval period. So this, if the silkworm is feeding on mulberry silk or different silkworm, they will feed on their different host. So what will happen? From that time only they will secrete these two protein while making the cocoon. So the fibroin percentage is 75% to 80% and sericin is 20% to 25%. Although several commercial species of silkworm is there, but Bombyx mori is most widely used. Around 95% of the total silk is produced by the India from the mulberry silkworm. And first country in the production of silk is China, followed by India. And in India, Karnataka state is highest in producing this mulberry silk. Then we will see voltinism. What is the meaning of voltinism? It is the ability of many insect group to produce from one to several generation in a year. Suppose one species, they are producing one generation per year. So it is their univoltine insect. Then if they are producing two generation per year, then they are bivoltine insect. If they are producing several generation per year, then they are multivoltine insect. So in case of silkworm, you will find these three categories. Like there, some species are univoltine, some are bivoltine, some are multivoltine. That's why voltinism is the major characters of the silkworm. So you can see multivoltine, bivoltine and monovoltine in case of the Bombyx mori. So Bombyx mori means mulberry silkworm. So how their larva will look in case of bi, then multi, then univoltine. So even the color of the cocoon will also change in case of the these three different voltines. Next we'll see univoltine races. So uni means we know they will produce one generation per year. The larval weight of here, the larval weight is comparatively higher and cocoons are also heavy. In case of uni, you will find the larval weight is higher and cocoons are heavy. But it is not suitable for summer and winter rearing because they are very sensitive towards this summer and winter time. The larva will get weak against the unfavorable condition. So they need very favorable condition and they cannot grow in this summer and winter seasons. So they lay only diapausing eggs. Then all the European races are univoltine. So remember the characters. Then we'll see bivoltine. So they produce two generation per year. Here the larval period is short and the leaf consumption of the larva, whenever they will consume the leaf to produce the cocoon, so that leaf consumption to the production of cocoon is less. Suppose they are producing more leaf, but they are giving less cocoon. Okay, so that ratio is here less. Suppose they will consume more leaf, but the cocoon they are producing is less. And the quality of the cocoon are also inferior. Then cocoon weight, shell weight, they are also lesser than the other voltine. So bivoltine is not good. Most of the temperate races are bivoltine. They both lay hibernating as well as non-hibernating eggs. Then multivoltine we'll see. They produce 5 to 6 generation per year. Then here also the larval duration is short. Then the most of the multivoltine or the polyvoltine races, the leaf cocoon ratio is high. Here the leaf cocoon ratio is high. If they are eating more leaf, they will produce more cocoon. The length of the filament is short, means filament means the thread length, the silk thread length is short. Then the cocoon filament is fine and clean with little lossiness, but more luscious. So this thing, whenever the silk will produce, the silk thread will produce, so that are very fine and clean and glossy appearance is there. They will shine. So glossy appearance you will find on the silk thread of this multivoltine race. Next, the larvae are robust and can tolerate fluctuating environment. So the larvae are little bit fat and strong, so they can tolerate the environmental condition, fluctuating environmental condition. But see, you have seen in case of the univoltine, they cannot tolerate the summer and winter season. So best is multivoltine, because they are not very much susceptible to the fluctuating environmental climate. So you can use this multivoltine races. So they lay only non-diapausing eggs. So here they will lay the egg only non-diapausing. What is the meaning of diapausing? What is the meaning of non-diapausing? See, diapausing means whenever they will lay the egg will go to a resting period, means inactive period. So they will not hatch. And non-diapausing means they will not go to any resting period. As the time comes, they will hatch and the larva will come out. So multivoltine races means the egg will not go in diapause. So they will lay the non-diapausing eggs. Next, this is the biology of silkworm. So see, first this is the non-diapausing egg. Non-diapausing eggs, I told, 9 to 12 days only they will start hatching. After laying of this egg, within 9 to 12 days they will start hatching. Then they are having 5 larval instar. Okay, 5 larval instar. So this is the first instar, second instar, third instar, fourth instar and fifth instar. Then after this fifth instar larva will stop feeding. So here you have to give them mulberry leaf. Okay, you have to give them mulberry leaf for feeding. And in this case, in first molt, second molt, you have to give chopped mulberry leaf, because they will be very small and they cannot feed on the whole mulberry leaf. Then third, fourth, fifth, you have to give whole mulberry leaf. And in case of the fifth larval instar, you have to feed very less, because they will start spinning that time and they will stop feeding. So once they will start spinning, they will form the pupa inside the cocoon. Then they will come out by making a hole from the cocoon. They will mate. Again, they will lay the egg. But in case of the diapause egg, suppose the silkworm, they are producing diapause egg. Already I told, the diapause eggs means they will undergo in inactive period. So this diapause egg will become black to purple color, because we know the mulberry silkworm egg color is light yellow in color. So here in non-diapause egg, the color will not change. But in case of diapause egg, first they will lay the yellow color, but after some time it will become dark in color. So this egg, you have to provide the artificial incubation chamber for them. Then only they will hatch out. Then this life cycle will start. Same thing. So next class we'll see the growth stages of the silkworm.